Proverbs chapter 28. The wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. Now that's kind of an oddball. What would you flee if there was nobody pursuing you? Yeah, but why are we a Prozac nation? Why are we a nation of anxieties and fears and troubles and anguish? Why is one the multi-million dollar, if not billion dollar, industry is pharmaceuticals? You know, they teach you, oh, you shouldn't fear, you shouldn't judge, but yet we are a nation that's under fear and judgment. And if you stand bold in the Lord and right, I've got Acts 4:13. You wouldn't need, God has given us a sound mind, 1 Timothy chapter 1, not fear. And the verse is, the littlest thing, you're going to run. And it's just wrong. Just imagine a guy running and there's nobody chasing him. For the transgression of a land, not just Israel, a land, many are the princes thereof. What's it saying? The more transgression, to the more government employees. That's what it's saying. The more the princes you have in the government, the more the transgression, for all have sinned and come to show the glory of God. The more people you put in a government office, you just add in another sinner. Israel went wrong when they said, we want to be like the nations. We want a king. Well, why not God? God would have been the perfect, sinless, holy ruler, author of the nation. But by a man of understanding, one who has the word, who has his reference of God and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. You know, as Bible-believing, Christ-honoring Christians, are buried in the dirt, as they die, the Lord tarries, the more the state of this country and this world will grow worse. America and this world are not producing Christians. And by Christian, I mean someone who is a verb for the Lord, who judges their life, who does what the Bible tells them to do, to try to be a soldier, who can take the armor of the Lord and put it on properly and use it properly. And every once in a while, like I did Saturday, you just get upset with the world, and I mean, you just take your shield and just start swinging it. But, you know, you do things wrong. And you put it under the blood. The more a church fails into the world and gives in, the less that the state will prolong, it'll die out. As churches die out, we grow every day closer and closer to the Lord. The next big event in the church is, will you marry sodomites? And if you don't, you'll lose your 501c and you'll be persecuted, and what will you do? And how many churches out there not only will marry them, but have them in their clergy? A poor man that oppresseth the poor is like a sweeping rain which leaveth no food. You know the government is poor. When you got a bill that comes into your mailbox and you open it up and it's over $1 trillion that you have in debt, you're poor. And then you go after somebody who doesn't have money because you taxed them for everything. And you want more because you spent more than what you're supposed to spend. Rain is great. But if it don't grow no crops, what good is it? That's why God gave rain to grow food. But in the beginning, there was this kind of canopy mist thing. Rain came as a judgment upon man when the world was in wickedness. And yet, at the end of the tribulation, there will be the time of the latter. I forget. There's a latter rain, and there's another rain. Forget the name of it. That will be much needed after drought and after waters have been turned to blood. Imagine two homeless men. And one of them has the other in a blackmail kind of situation. That would make a comical movie. A television program. A comedy sketch. They that forsake the law. Now we're under the law in Proverbs. Solomon's under the law. They that forsake the law praise the wicked. To justify themselves. A preacher will rebuke. A Christian with a Bible will give you your error. But a wicked man and a wicked man will praise each other to make themselves look good. Why won't a lost man go into church? Because he doesn't want the truth as much as a robber will go look for a cop. But such as keep the law, contend with them. By their right living. By standing on the street corner and preaching hell. By knocking on their door and giving them the gospel. And it's getting harder every day. I thank God it worked today. They were doing work on the freezers last night. I do it because my boss would tell me to do it, but I didn't have to touch beer. Working on the beer coolers in a grocery store. It's in the convenience store. The music that's piped in the overhead. That kind of stuff I won't allow in my car. That kind of stuff I won't live in my house. Why don't we stand up and say, call the police, say, we're not going to shop there no more while you continue to have that filth. Because we don't want to stand up for God. Oh, but, you know, if we don't like the president or we don't like, you know, the taxation, we'll speak up for that. While your ears Again, I tell you, John Bunyan's Holy War, the ear gate. You got the, you know, after Satan got into man's soul, when God sends his troops, the troops go to the first gate of ear gate with the trumpet. Evil men understand not judgment. Judge not, lest ye be judged. They don't understand. You judge every day. Some lose a judgment. Some don't understand your underwear is not to be seen. That's a judgment. Clothes are judgment. Do I show too much? Does it match? Do I walk? Do I run? Do I stop? That's judgment. But they don't understand the judgment of God. They don't understand. Let's see if I can get this right. Seeing, smelling, tasting, hearing, and what you touch, the five senses, will be judged by God, saved or lost. They don't understand that. God wouldn't judge me, they say. But they that seek the Lord understand all things. And many will not seek John 3:18-20 and Mark 4:11. They don't want to know. And they think that if I don't know, what I don't know will not hurt me. And when I get up to preach, most of the time, 90% of the time, I will say something, I have left you without excuse. But many don't want to hear that. Better is the poor that walketh in his uprightness than he that is perverse in his ways, though he be rich. Luke 16, the rich man and Lazarus, is a perfect illustration in that verse. Whoso keepeth the law is a wise son. Now, I'm not saved by the law. But if I don't commit adultery, I'm wise. If I don't tell false, if I don't be a false witness, I think I said that right. If I don't lie, I am a good, wise son to God my Father. If I am not coveting, I'm doing good in the eyes of God my Father. But I'm not saved and put under the law like those in the Old Testament. All but the Sabbath. And even the Sabbath, give yourself a rest, are all proper. For a Christian, not for salvation, but it'd be right. It'd give you a good testimony. But he that is a companion of righteous, troublesome, Ferguson, Missouri, Los Angeles, Chicago, New York, the Bronx, Orlando, Austin, and you name all the righteous cities. And shameth his father. You know what's sad about that verse in America? I said, I'm going to go through these. I started this in the beginning. I said, I'm going to mention America many times and you may not like it. And it's a sad fact that those LA riots for OJ, for Rodney King, for the Brown family and Ferguson and all the others. There are many teenagers and adult, you would say adult, I say that tongue in cheek. They don't even know who their father is, and their father doesn't even know who they are, and they don't care. Lester Lerov said in the 70s, before he died, imagine if he were living today. In the 70s, with the troubles that they were having with the teenagers then, far more worse today. They are killing each other and killing themselves because they don't have Jesus Christ the hope. What hope do they have? What hopeless life do they have today, not knowing Jesus Christ and not even knowing who their parents are? And maybe being ashamed. And yet here we are in Florida in 2014, and a federal judge has ruled that you cannot take a drug test to get your welfare status. I guess you're not getting welfare just to take care of your children, I guess. I mean, listen, if you're working part-time job, the only jobs there are, and you can, hey, if you work, you should get some help. I'm for that. But if you're just going to smoke crack all day and not even take care of your own kids and let the government, you don't deserve the money. There is a shame today, and there's a breaking away of our youth today because they can't even reference their life to God the Father because they ain't got an earthly father. Even Jesus Christ, our Lord in the flesh, had an earthly father. Not only did God choose Mary, a virtuous woman, but he also, the thing we don't know much about Joseph, but I guarantee Joseph was a hard-working man. God would not have put Jesus he wouldn't choose any of these ghetto cities for a father, for the life of his son. And you may not like that statement, but it's a true statement. And yet, these men run and hide. They don't even know who they're going to stand before God, before the judgment, and they're going to be judged as a father, even though they don't even know who the kid is. You're a father no matter what. We're living like animals. Don't you see what evolution's teaching? You know, the dog down the street comes over your property and has his business with your dog, and your dog produces puppies, and that dog goes right back down in the street, and those puppies don't know who the father is. Don't you see we are in evolution now? I'm the top dog, and if you're in my way, I'm going to get a gun or a stick or a rock. I'm going to kill you. At least Cain killed Abel because there was a relationship problem with God. God was involved. He that by usury, interest, payments, charges, and unjust gain increases his substance, he shall gather it for him that will pity the poor. Interest is Leviticus 25:36, Ezekiel 18:13, Zechariah 14:14, and Acts 5:4. It's the charging of the use of your money. And that was forbidden under the law to a Jew. Now, the Jew could charge the Gentiles, but they were not to charge each other. He that turns away his ear from hearing the law. He won't listen to the priest, he won't listen to the prophet, and he won't listen to, this is before synagogue, the temple. You do know that there were priests all through the tribes of Israel to teach. And then the three times a year they would be in Jerusalem where the main feasts. But each city and area had their priests. Even Samuel went around in a circuit, teaching the people what they should do. Judges was, every man did that which is right in his own eyes, I think it is. They didn't have a teaching priest. And in Jeremiah, when Nebuchadnezzar came in and wiped out the land. No, that's not Nebuchadnezzar. When they took northern Israel. And Asia came and took, Assyria came and took them. And they left poor the land. And they said, you know what? The lions are eating the people. We got to send some priests down there to teach them what to do in the land. And the problem is they sent Jezebel's prophets. And it says every man served God, but then they served their own gods. And you have your Baptist church and your other church today. You know, they worship God, and then they have, you know, the Christmas and the Easter and the other gods involved. Even his prayer shall be an abomination. When you turn your ears away from what God's telling you to do, that is a hindrance to prayer. You might as well not even pray until you get right. What is the law for us that God tells us that may affect our prayer? Love thy neighbor as yourself. If you don't love your neighbor, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, if you don't confess with your mouth Jesus, don't. First John 1:9. Putting your sins under the blood. If you don't do that, you've got hindrance of prayer. Go ye all over the world, preach the gospel. You don't do that. You got it. Whoso causes the righteous to go astray in his, go astray in an evil way. Jehovah Witnesses will grab onto a Christian and guide them to the wrong, evil way. He shall fall himself in his own pit. That's the hole to catch animals. To catch a lion without getting eaten. Lion, I said. The devil as a lion, your adversary. Seeketh whom he may devour. You got to catch that lion so that guy doesn't call up. I didn't go to work there. There's a lion in the street. Excuse me. Yeah, there was a lion in the street, but he's in the pit now. You can come to work. If you take a Christian and convert him to anything but the Bible, what about if you take a Christian and you convert him to a non-Bible? What if you take a Christian and convert him to ways of the golden rule? What if you take a Christian and convert him, you know, let your light shine? Jesus warned the Pharisees, and you go out and you get apostolate and you make them two-fold child worse than hell than you are. About the children, woe unto you, you know, it'd be better if you hang the millstone about your neck. Children, aren't we adopted in God's family? You better be very careful what you do with a Christian. You know what Paul said? If what you eat offends a Christian, you not only offend that Christian, you offend God. You know what God told Paul? Paul, why persecutest thou me? When did Paul persecute Jesus? When he persecuted the Christian. You be very careful in what you do with the righteous. If you put him astray, that God takes to his account what you did to him and not to the person. There's a firm warning. You know, if you get into a pit, there's no way out. Even if you grab the branches or whatever they cover that pit with, they're going to fall down in a hole with you. You can't climb out. But the upright, opposite the one that leads astray, shall have good things in possession. You better be careful what you do to a brother or sister in the Lord. An evil way. What if you do something to have them just turn away and walk away from God? What if you become one of those hypocrites that they talk about? What if you become that preacher that runs off with the piano player? Or the treasurer that steals the money? See, you didn't realize, did you? Your conduct, your sin affects others. Be very careful. The rich man is wise in his own conceit. Because he's rich. That is why. If God didn't love me, he wouldn't give me all his money. I've got to be right. I'm rich. You're not. That's improper judgment. You take 10 of the richest men in the world and measly little me, who's nobody. And let's see if our names, or whose name, or names, are in the most precious book ever to be, the Lamb's Book of Life. My name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And brother, I got riches. Because I have a Father in heaven, my Creator, that is ultimate rich. Bars of gold? I've got a God that can speak a ball of fire into existence that's been burning for, what, 6,000 years? But the poor that have understanding searches him out. Now, what's that mean? I don't want to live like that guy. Man, he's got a security system. He's worried about this. His desk has got Pepto-Bismol, Alka-Seltzer. He's got all these pills. His children hate him, don't know who he is, use him so they can get the big important cars. Everybody talks behind his back, and the guy is a jerk. And his wife's cheating on him. But he's rich. He's CEO. He's a manager. And you're a fool. I don't want to live like you. I was listening to Pastor Roloff the other day. And I don't want to say pride, but you know, he said, there are a few families. He says they start off the week, they go to Sunday school. Then they hear preaching. And they go home, they have a meal, or have a meal in the church grounds, and you go back Sunday night and you get more Bible. He says on Monday, he said the family has church devotion. And on Tuesday, the family opens the Bible. And Wednesday night, midweek service, the family's at the church to get more Bible. And he says on Thursday, the family's got the open Bible. And he says on Friday, they got an open Bible. And on Saturday, they got a seven-day week Bible. He said, that's dying. Not in my family. I love my wife and children. Hey, it's time for me to go for work. You said I'm supposed to get out this time. Bye. 1 minute after seven, he's in the car. Don't you understand? No. You liars, you cheaters, you miserable persons. I want to get away from you as soon as I can. I want to get in the Lord. I want to get with my family. Or I'm happy and joyful. Think I want your miserable life? I see your life. I look at your life, verse 11. I don't want it. When righteous men do rejoice, that's me, Luke 19:7. When righteous men do rejoice, there is great joy. Great glory. 1 Kings 8:11, 2 Chronicles 5:14. But when the wicked rise, the Antichrist, 2 Thessalonians 2:8, the wicked. Pay attention when you see the wicked. That's not only the wicked people, but that's a pure, more sure reference to the Antichrist. The wicked. The wicked one. The wicked rise, a man is hidden. He's running from the Antichrist, Matthew 24:13 or 15. You can read 13 and 15. Get a couple verses in there. I just said, listen, I'm supposed to work. The Bible says I'm supposed to work. That's a wicked place. I'm out of there. Bye as soon as I can. Hey, I show up early to know what I have to do. I punch in at the right time. And when you say I'm supposed to be out of there, listen, I'm not sticking around with the world. I'm going to where the Lord is. It's kind of hard to serve the Lord with my ears when I'm listening and I'm able to thank God that I can listen to the MP3 player. And I can still hear that crap over the intercom. You know, I've seen Santa kissing mommy, and you know, grandma got ran over by the reindeer, and last night, sweet, sugary Santa. Don't want to stay! You take my gospel tracks, I put in the bathroom on my time, and you rip them up and put them in the garbage can. You don't want me there either. Because in aisle 7 is Stiley and Jesus Christ together. You don't want me. And I don't want you. I'm telling you. But when the wicked rise, that man is hidden. You run. Get out of there. That's exactly what they're going to do as soon as they realize who the Antichrist is. And that's written to a Jew. He that covers his sins shall not prosper. Now let me read you something. You don't have to turn it on. I'm going to go and read to you 1 John 1:9. I'm going to read it to you right out of the Bible so you can't say I have my own private interpretation. As soon as I find it, Peter, Jude. Watch, we'll be back to Peter again. Oh, 2 John. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. He that covers his sins shall not prosper. If your sins are still on you when you die, you will burn in hell because you rejected what God's told you to do. And the law would have been what the law prescribed. But you still had to wait for Jesus Christ. Today, if your sins are still on you, you have rejected Jesus Christ as your Savior. If you have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, and then after that, you don't plead the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ for your sins, you're not going to prosper. Your works are going to burn up. The smoke detectors in heaven will be going off at the judgment seat of Christ. And you'll be grasping and holding ashes. Remember what he said last night? Ashes are nothing. You ever wonder... This came to my thought right now, the goofy things I ever think of. Can you imagine after the judgment seat of Christ, that one angel is going to scoop up all that ashes and put it into the heavenly dumpster? How big is that dumpster going to have to be? You know, there was, when there were just fireplaces, there was a metal bucket that you went over and you scoop all the ashes out and you put them in that bucket and you put them outside, give them a chance to cool down. And, you know, you got rid of it. Can you imagine if God gave you a bucket at the judgment seat of Christ and said, here, pick up your ashes. Now, when you bend over and pick up those ashes, does any crowns fall off your head? When you go to pick up those ashes, you get down, do you have to... take that crown and place it on your head so it's not going to fall off? Or will you not need worry because you won't have any crown at all? I mean, as you're walking through all the Christians and you got your bucket of ashes and you can look at Christians, you can look at your pastor, you can look at your family and say, only a sinner. Look at the ashes. And then... touch your crown and say, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Can you do that? We're all going to have ashes. But whoso confesses and forsakes them shall have mercy. How about that? Do you run and hide from your sins? Or you just do them? Happy is the man that feareth always. What? a meteor's gonna come through my living room. An airplane's gonna crash. Somebody's gonna run. No, it's not the fear. The fear of doing your God wrong. In your conduct. What you say, what you do, where you are. What you are. Well, that will give your God a bad name. Job is a perfect example in the Bible. Man, Satan brought the accusations and Job stood firm in the Lord. That put a smile on God's face. Does your life make God smile or does it make Satan smile? When Satan brings an accusation of you before God, can Satan take his finger and point at God's face and say, I told you so? When Satan brings that sin in your life to God, and God looks over in the right hand and says, son, what about that? And the book is open and the son looks to the father and says, and Satan says, see you, God. I got some people going to burn babies to me. Bye. Satan goes up to God and says, you see that sin? Father turns to the son in his right hand and says, son, what about that? The book is open. He says, father, as far as the accusation of that wicked one, all I got to say is, what sins are you talking about? All I see is blood and tears. I see his tears and I see my blood. That's all I see. Didn't David say, take my tears and put them in a bottle? With a label, sin, the tears of the sins, and the blood of Jesus. What sins are you talking about? But he that hardens his heart shall fall into mischief. Anybody know anybody in the Bible that hardened their heart? Pharaoh did. Exodus 4:21 and 3:19. You know what happened to Pharaoh? Now you're not going to believe this. You know Pharaoh had two lives? Do you know in some churches, Pharaoh went back home to the palace and had a good old rest of his life? He didn't die. I fought with a man about that. I'm going to teach my Sunday school. Pharaoh didn't die. You couldn't find in the Bible Pharaoh died. Man, I told him all the places where Pharaoh died. That man died early. Pharaoh ended up at the bottom of the Red Sea. You know how much water is in the Red Sea? I'll tell you how much. I have no idea. It's a sea. And Pharaoh today is in hell wanting just a drop of water so he can cool the tip of his tongue. The guy drowned in the bottom of the sea, and yet today he has no water. Isn't that ironic? And we're going to close right there, and we're going to pick up with the Antichrist in 14, which we just read. Because you know where the Antichrist ends up? Ends up in the lake of fire. Isn't that ironic? But we'll pick up in verse 15 tomorrow, Lord willing.